Sound of my voice all over the world. Thank you for being part of this midweek service of studies of the New Testament, what we call life applicable New Testament study. You know, the way we do it is throughout the rest of this year we'll be doing New Testament teaching, and I think maybe we'll be breaking it into quarterly. You know, one quarter we'll focus on praying and praying and praying, another quarter we're going to New Testament teaching, another quarter we're going to pray, another quarter New Testament praying, so that we can balance the midweek service of praise God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you and appreciate you and honor you and adore you, because your good and your mercy endures forever. Entrance of your word gives life, gives understanding to everyone who is engaged thereof. We pray therefore that light and life will come.
Amen.
Just as Christ has brought immortality and life to light, it will come to light for everyone that which is necessary for living and for life.
Amen.
True, applicable studying of your word. And the name of Jesus be glorified.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Psalm 100 and verse 3 to 5 says, enter his court with gate and his with praise and his gate with thanksgiving. So let's go ahead and just for a few minutes, let's just thank God and appreciate Him and honor Him and adore Him and give Him glory and give Him honor and say, Lord, well, thank You. We Your people, creation of Your hand, men and women whom You have made in Your image and after Your own likeness, we've come to say thank You. By Christ, we bring unto You sacrifice of praise, even the fruits of our lips, glorifying You. So go ahead and glorify Him, exalt Him, magnify Him, adore Him, lift Him up, and raise Him high, and honor Him, King of all kings and the Lord of all lords, the unchanging God, the immortal and the invisible God, the only wise God who is worthy of all praise, the only potentate that has immortality in light. Give Him praise. Worship Him. We worship You. 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 We give You all the praise. We give You all adorations. Oh yes, Lord. We give You praise. We give You praise. We give You praise. We give You praise. Blessed be Your name. I exalt You. Whatever You say, I exalt You, Lord. I exalt You. I exalt You, Lord. I exalt You, oh God, oh, oh God. I exalt You, Lord. I exalt You. I exalt You, Lord. I exalt You. I exalt You, Lord. I exalt You. Yes, Lord, I exalt You, Lord. I exalt You. I exalt You, Lord. I exalt You. Oh, Lord. You, Lord, I exalt You. Come on, say, I exalt You, Lord, I exalt You. Oh God,
oh God.
Thank You, Holy Spirit. We worship You, God in heaven, through our Lord Jesus Christ. We honor You and adore You today. And we give You all the praise. In Jesus' precious name we worship.
Amen.
All right. Before we go into the teaching today, I like those of us who do attend the service in church on Sunday to know, as it was sent out through the church communication platform, that according to the government directives in the United Kingdom here, there's QR code pasted at the door of every government building now, and in particular the building, our church venue is part of such building that is affected or that is directed to do that. So you are expected on your phone or any of your plans, either iPad but preferably phone, either the Android base or the iOS base, and these are the two common phones now. You go on the app, you download NHS COVID app, and that's it. Once you do that, when you come to church on Sunday, at the door, you will see the scanning code on the door. You just go to check in and just present your phone to it. You just pick it and acknowledge that you are in that particular place. The choice of trace and track is yours on your app, so it's not something that is complicated, you know. And so I want you to, and like we said, just one person per household, you know, is it's required. Doesn't mean if everybody wants to do it, I mean, you say no, but at least one person per household, praise God. All right, and so let's do the teaching today from the exposition from the book of 1 Corinthians, where we are. We've done one lesson from 1 Corinthians. Apparently, we won't be able to do we won't be able to do more than a few verses as well today. So before we finish 1 Corinthians, I think we might have four lessons. So the last lesson we saw, the divine assignment as it concerns individual and a group of people, and we realized from the first seven verses of 1 Corinthians, the first nine verses rather, that clarity of calling and purpose is one of the way out of insecurity that pushes people to becoming control freaks and manipulators and all of that, whether in private or in public platform. We said that genuine assignment must be properly focused. It must be about the Lord who assigns. It must be about what God wants to accomplish in the assignment in the life of people. We said genuine assignment adds value to people, doesn't take value away from people. And we also said that genuine assignment increases those to whom it's been sent. Okay, good. So today I want us to go to 1 Corinthians and read 8 verses. Then we'll be able to do 8 verses today. So starting from verse 10 all the way to verse 17. Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it has been declared or reported to me concerning you, brethren, by those of close household, that there are contentions among you. Now I say this, that each of you say, I am of Paul, or I am of Apollos, or I am of Cephas, or I am of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, lest anyone should say that I had baptized in my own name. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanas. Besides, I do not know whether I baptized any other. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of no effect. I believe we should stop there, because by the time we finish dealing with those 8 verses, our 50 minutes or so will have been thoroughly spent, and then we won't have a choice but to call it a day. From the body language of that of the scripture verses we read now, you will see that the scripture is dealing with division and sectarianism and the clannish spirit. Now, I want us to understand in a very clear thing that the New Testament is the final authority when it comes to church. It's either you look at the gospel in the context of finished work of Christ, or you look at the epistle literally, or you look at every other scripture in the context of finished work of Christ. But the New Testament, as it were, is the final authority. I've heard preacher being compared to Paul, that, oh, this brother, this pastor is a great man of God. In fact, he has Pauline level of revelation, all of that. Now, those are men commendations. They don't hold water with God. If Pastor so-so and so is counted worthy of God and Christ, the owner of the church, to have a sacrosanct opinion about how Christianity and what Christianity should be, he will have sent Pastor so-and-so at the foundation of the church. The foundation of the body of Christ Scripture said there's no other foundation that anyone can lay but that which has been laid on, which is Christ, the cornerstone, and then it was laid on the ministry of the apostles and prophets. There's no apostle in this generation, no prophet in this age that is qualified for such. There's nobody. Not even in the last 1,000 or 1,500 years. The apostle and prophet referred to as the foundation of the church were the founding apostle. And that is why, so it's closed already. There's no entry for anyone into that realm again. Every other person who comes has to line up. And if somebody can't line up, and if somebody doesn't line up, the person is on his own. The scripture is safe. And you know that's why there were boundaries. God deliberately set scripture as boundaries. If not so, we can as well bring all knowledge from Confucius and from everywhere and just module everything together. But the Bible says all scriptures are given by the inspiration of the Spirit of God and it's already sealed. Amen. Amen. So, and that gives you an idea. So, when you look at this scripture, so like I said, it's talking about division and sectarianism. So today, let's look at denominations and sectarianism. So if we want to put topic to all those eight verses. And what does the scripture say? Not what I feel, not what somebody says, not what one big man of God or small man of God says. What does the scripture say? Get me now. And that's what truly matters. And that is the safe place for you as a person, as a Christian, to take position. Scriptures are not for argument. Scripture are not for us to go into debate and argument and name calling. No. Scripture is for somebody to learn and to do. And when you do that, your profiting will appear. It's as simple as that. So let's start from, so let's look at denomination and sectarianism. So the first thing I want us to look at today is the fact that God allows diversity. So which means denomination is allowed by God, promoted by God, enhanced by God's Spirit. And if God allows it, then it's not evil. Then it's not bad. There's nothing wrong with denomination. There's nothing wrong with denomination either along national line, along ethnic lines, along any line. As long as it's done in line and in tune with the purpose of God. For example, there are people, from the scripture we read, it's so simple that there are a stream of believers who align more with Paul, or very likely they came into the body of Christ and were raised under Paul ministry, some under Apollos ministry, some under Peter or Cephas ministry. Now, and of course, aside that, we also know that there is the social interaction side of Christianity. Every time the Church of Christ goes from one place to the other, it carries two elements. The first element, it comes with it, which is the gospel, which is the, it said, great is the mystery of godliness, that God was manifest in flesh, declared by angels, seen of men, quickened, justified in the Spirit, and preached to all. That is the mystery of the advent of Christ. The incarnation of God as man in the person of Jesus, his death, his resurrection, undisputable. But every time the gospel gets somewhere, it takes on the social structure or the of that place or the culture.
Yes.
Because that's the only way it could be related with.
Mm.
So for example, when you see an African man pray, you know it's an African man. When you see a British man pray, you know it's a British man. When you even see British song. For example, if you are in an African community, dancing is one major thing, and that's why it's easier for African to relate with David. How we dance like David dance. There are some people who don't dance, doesn't mean they're not worshiping God too. You know, but for, so the two elements of that always constitute the congregation of the Lord, of God's people, which is the gospel, which is the substance, then the social interaction, which is to enhance the gospel finding its way, its entry and establishment amongst the people. So based on that, God allows diversity. I want us to go back to those scripture and start reading it and biting it one after the other. Verse 10 says, "Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." That is the nucleus. That's the nucleus in the church. He said that you all speak the same thing, which means they naturally don't speak the same thing. That there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together. Now, in the same mind and in the same judgment, I want you to look at what I want to demonstrate here. Now, if you look at the camera, I stretch my hand here now. That's my hand. It's just one person's hand. It doesn't need to be joined together with anything. It's already one hand. But let's say we're in the meeting and I say, let's join our hands together. So which means other person, other people, somebody else. Now if, so when the scripture is saying here that you may be perfectly joined together, which means the scripture recognizes the individuality or the diversity in what constituted the congregation or the church there. It's not just one person or one group or one ethnic. So he said, God recognizes the diversity. God recognizes the individuality. But the aim of God is that it be joined together. See that now? So when we say God allows diversity, to what end does God allow diversity? So people have asked the question before, why are there denominations? Denomination is not evil. Lutheran, Catholic, Baptist, Church of Reformation, Diadem, Redeem, whatever it is. It's not evil. It's not even. It is what will allow the gospel to find perfect entrance and establishment in nations of men or among humans because of the diversity. So God allowed diversity, or what we call denomination, number one, so that we may speak the same thing in different ways. You see, you're a born-again Christian, you need to understand something. That everybody won't speak the same thing the way you would speak it. So God, the owner of the church himself, will allow us to speak the same thing in different ways. And that's why he diversified giftings, fulcrums, leverages to which the gospel is communicated. I want us to read from the book of Acts and chapter 2. You will understand that, and you know you can't be wiser than the owner of the church. You can't be holier than the owner of the church. The owner of the church, it doesn't make mistake. Let's read from Acts and chapter 2 and from verse 5. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation. So number one, there were Jews. Number two, there were devout men from every nation under heaven. So there were Jews, which is a group of people, then devout men. Devout men means they are proselyte. They are people who, over years of either having been exposed to the Torah or the book of the Jews or to Jews, they've recognized the gods of the Jews as God and they've joined to that. So the Bible said God-fearing, you see, so they are in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation. In the real context of this scripture is that there are Jews and there are devout men from every nation under heaven. And when the sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused because everyone heard them speak in his own language. So they were not just Jews. Hmm. If they were just Jews, mm-hmm. Jews speak only one language, mm-hmm. Yiddish. Or Aramaic, depending on what time it was. But look at them. They came together and they they had them speak in every man in his own language. They had different language. So which means if a Greek man was there, he had them speaking Greek. If a Arabian man was there, he had them speak Arabian. If a Swedish man was there, he had them speak Swedish. You know, if an English man was there, he had them speak English. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, look, and not all these who speak Galilean, say now, they all speak Galilean, which is the dominant language spoken by the area where Jesus came naturally, which is where most of the apostles came from. And how is it that we hear each in our own language in which we were born? See now, Parisians, see now, Medes. Medes was the language they speak in what you call Iraq and Iran today. Parthians, Medes, Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, that's Iran, Iraq, what you call Jordan and Anfar, and Judea, and Cappadocia, and Pontus, and Asia, and Phrygia, and Pamphylia, even Egypt. I'm sure some of the other people were there too. You know, Nigerians and Egypt, you know, and the part of Libya, you know, so Libyans were there too. So it's essentially, you know, there wasn't mapping of the world was not as good as now. So essentially what we are saying is that there were Europeans, there were Asians, and there were Africans. And those were who constitute nations. So Indians could be there then from Asia, you know, from Africa, people from Ghana, from Kenya, from Mozambique, Zimbabwe, Botswana, Kenya, all of those. You see, Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes. You see now, both Jews, that's what I was saying the other time. See, NIV didn't get that thing well. It said both Jews and proselytes. Proselytes were non-Jews who convert. Christians and Arabs, you see now, and Arabs. We hear them speak in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. So they were all perplexed and saying to one another, what could this mean? So even from the inception of the church, you will see God's diversity intention. Because God, if it is, you can imagine if the gospel is just the way Church of England preaches it. Now we just come, all of us sit down. You know, after a while, you know, something like, I can't flow with this. But that flows with some people. Some people find some churches noisy. Some people find, you know, so essentially, what we are saying is that even though we're saying it in different ways, but diversity is still for us to speak same thing. And what was the thing they were saying there? They were saying the wonderful works of God. They weren't saying how bad this other person is and how bad this text is. They were saying the wonderful works of God. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So that's one. God allowed diversity. Number two, to have the same mind behind diverse operation. And I want to show you that scripture again. Let's go back to that 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians and chapter 1. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You see now, he said that you speak the same thing, number one, that we have no division of you, but that you perfectly join in the same mind. One mind. One mind. What does that mean? It means to have the same mind behind this different operation. Look at what we are saying. So this is a doctrinal church. This is a church that teaches doctrine line upon line, title upon title, precept upon precept. Or this is just a woofing church like American church. I want to tell you now that Jesus Christ is Lord. Fine. Or this is a healing church. This is church that teaches healing and prosperity and all of that. Or this is just, he said, whatever it is, God allowed diversity, that even in that diversity, the mind behind diverse operation will still be the same.
Preach
it. See now, you see, diversity becomes trouble when the mind behind the operation is not the same. This other person is seeking for money, and this other person is seeking for self-glorification, and this other person is seeking to prove that he's the only one who is right, and this other person is seeking to prove, you know, people carry over the idiosyncrasy of their upbringing. People who have been brought up to argue with their brothers and sisters, that all their life they've argued, now they become a big pastor. They are looking for who to argue with on pulpit. They are looking for who to argue with on Facebook. They are looking for who to argue with on YouTube. I've had someone said, well, you might like me or you might hate me, but you can't ignore me. So you see an attention seeker. So even when there's nothing, we see prophecy that will draw attention. God said he's going to kill everybody. You know, and just, that's the only true prophet alive. It's not true. Some of the things people say are just carryover of, because the scripture says, even though it's diverse, the mind behind it will be the same. Let's look at what is the mind behind diverse oppression. Let's read from Philippians and chapter 2. You know, it's Bible study, so we use truth to establish truth so that, we will be able to get established soundly in the truth. Therefore, if there's any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection of mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love. See now, behind the mind will be love. So once it becomes a thing of hatred and people even wish other people go to hell. God judge and destroy all of them. You know, so he said, if behind the mind must be affection and mercy and the same law, being one accord of one mind. See now. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition. To get likes on Facebook, to get view. So we have 2 million people watching us now. We are even popular more than them. We are more than, you understand what I'm saying now? He said, once this is behind the mind, it might be sounding right, it's not right, it's not of God. Or conceit. But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other than himself. So, which means once it is to prove that you know better than others, you esteem yourself above others, you are not doing it from the right mind. So I don't mean to if we talk, I just want to say, let's even not talk of big picture, let's talk of even within group. I just want to say, you know that you mean evil in your heart with what you want to say, but you know you need to overcome that guilt. See now? See, so you don't want to overcome the guilt. So you just like, it's not that I'm not trying to say bad about people, but I think there was something happened in our church one time. You know, in a group, there was a conflict. I'll say it, there was conflict, and somebody came and said something in the group to and said, I don't mean bad, but it wasn't true. The person has run what the person wanted to say through another person in the group, and the person said, no, don't run that openly. Why don't you approach the person in the private? I said, no, I want to treat the person madness. I want to show the person. Yeah, the person has said that in the behind the scene. And then came up and said, it's not that I want to say something bad, but I think so, you know. And as a Christian, if you're a believer, you should purge yourself of such. You look at it. He said, in loneliness of mind, esteem yourself, let each of you look out for his, not for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. And look at verse 5. Let this mind, one mind, be in you, which also was in Christ, who being in form of God. It's that Jesus had accolades. He had accolades. He said he was in form of God. He didn't consider it robbery to be equal with God. He wasn't dragging it with God when he was on earth. And say, after all, most of what you see, we come there. We'll come there. So let's just do it as Bible study. You know, let me not preach it. He said, coming in likeness of man, being found in appearance of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has exalted him. So which means humble mind. Humble mind is to esteem others, not diminish others. You see now? So the only church doing the right thing in this nation, in this end time, we're the only one. So we're the only one. You see? And you look at this other pastor. No, you see, that mind is wrong. You are not esteeming others. You are esteeming yourself. See now, and that scripture says, if diversity is ordained of God, it will promote us speak the same thing, even though in diverse way. It will promote us to have the same mind behind diverse operation. He said, and have the same judgment, which means to bear the same discretion as people who have been redeemed from the fall. So there's a way a people who have been redeemed from the fall, from the fall, behave. Now, listen to me. When you go to churches, watch out how people get into conflict and resolve conflict. It doesn't matter how much tongue you speak. That is the true litmus test of the heart of people. People who have been redeemed from the fall have a way of thinking and of dealing with others. Is it because of this born again? I know my level. I know. Let's read that scripture to you again so that you will get what we're saying today. Now, let's go to that Philippians and verse chapter 2, verse 1 again. Let's read it. You know, it will be good for us to read it again. Put it on the screen for everyone. Therefore, if there's any consolation, which means if you have found anything in Christ, since the day you've been coming to church and you have been praying and you have been shouting, if any comfort of love, which means if the love of Christ has really comforted your heart, you know that being born again is worth it. If any fellowship of the Spirit, if you have the Holy Ghost indeed, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like my, which means what he's simply saying is, if you have been rescued from the fall, let it show. I tell you the truth. Many, he said, so going back to that First Corinthians again now, so let's go back to our text, First Corinthians, verse 10. Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you speak the same thing and that you be of no, there be no division among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Now, it's not talking about uniformity, it's talking about unity. We can't be uniform. We have different tastes, different choices, and all of that, background, and all of that. But he said, if we have truly been rescued from the fall that mankind was cast into through the fall of Adam, if you have truly come into the affection of God in Christ Jesus, he said, there's a way it will affect your mind. So Christianity is more than I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't commit fornication, and all that. No, those. There are people who are not born again who don't do all of those things too. So he's saying that we need to see it in more, much, much more than that for you as a believer. If your mind has truly been rescued, praise God.
Hallelujah.
So the first thing to establish there is that diversity is allowed of God and is to promote the gospel among people. Number two thing we need to look at today is that Satan utters sectarianism, spirit of clannishness, is offered by the devil. Now let's go back and read it from that First Corinthians chapter 1 verse 11. For it has been declared or reported to me concerning you, my brethren, your brethren, by those of close household, that there are contention among you. I say this, that each of you say, I'm of Paul, I'm of Paul, I'm of Cephas, I'm of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? Which means, the real thing that brought them to the gospel, they've departed from it. What separated them from unbelievers has now become secondary. I know what separates us from unbeliever becomes secondary. Then the benefit of Christianity, whether here or not or in eternity, might just be a dream that might not come true. Now let's read it again. So the first sign that Satan is at work is contention. Contention. What's contention? Working against one another to gain advantage or preeminence. So which means, for example, if, let's start from pastor, then we'll bring it down to members. If denomination A is in the name of whatever, in the name of we are the one who have the new revelation, we are the one who understand grace, we are the one who understand holiness, we are the one who understand sanctification, we are the one who understand healing, this is where miracle happened by the, at the breath of the of our man of God, it makes no difference. Once the language, both the body language, the activity, the actions, is to work against other denomination to gain undue advantage or preeminence over them, you are dealing in contention and it's not of God. So let's bring it to individuals. Once, as an individual, whether within a group in the church, within a group, within choir or drama or usher or whatever group you belong to, or church A and church B, it makes no, he said, once there is contention, it's not God. And what's contention? Working against one another to gain advantage or preeminence. Advantage, whether numerical advantage, financial advantage, followership advantage. Don't listen to Pastor XYZ. He's from the devil. Those you people following him, come and hear the truth. This is the only place where there's truth. It's not true. It's not true. That is contention. In fact, people who truly know truth in the body of Christ, who want to correct error, let me show you the way they do it. If they see a crooked tree, they bring a straight tree. I said, this tree is crooked, this is straight. And lay it bare. Once you go into personality fighting, talk less of now name calling, you are dealing in contention. You are not of God. It's as simple as that. It's of the devil. Now look at it. So, Satan utters sectarianism, because at the end of the day, what will happen? Personality cult. So sectarianism promotes and push for personality cult. So you now have, I am of Paul, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Cephas. It's personality cult. Before you know it, we even have beret, emblem, things that people want to separate each other. So even if somebody's praying, say that's of Paul, I'm not saying amen. Mm-hmm. That's of Apollos, I'm not saying amen. You know what I mean now? Mm-hmm. So they will have personality cult, dividing Christ. Mm-hmm. The owner of the church said, by this shall men know that you are my disciple, when you love one another. Now someone said, no, I know that's what Jesus said, but the God is angry. Listen, you need to take it very easy now and understand what the scripture is saying, that sectarianism is from Satan and is marked by contention, is marked by pushing for and promoting personality cult. Our man of God, our own bishop, our own apostle, our own, that's the only person. So what will happen? You divide Christ, and then they will start exalting personal attributes, greatness and influence beyond the work of redemption. I want you to understand something, that God is going to give people in the body of Christ different great attributes, great giftings, prophetic gifting, healing gifting, eloquence, and all of that. But once those become, you know, what we exalt about the work of redemption, then we are dealing in sectarianism. John Wesley of blessed memory, the pioneer of the Methodist movement, with his brother Charles, were extremely sectarian when they were alive. John Wesley really was a man of doctrine, and he couldn't suffer fool when it comes to doctrine. He wouldn't allow anything contrary. So there were the Arminian and the Calvinists and all of that, and it was they always had war of war. So that at the end of the day, you're preparing sermon, you're looking for who you say is shaking table. You're not shaking no table. Sermon is not to shake table. You understand what I'm saying now? Now, when John Wesley grew older and he was dying, he had something he said to his brother Charles, who was younger than him. He said he had finally discovered that the rightness of doctrine is not the ultimate, but being able to walk in love. But he was hold. Are you getting me now? So once we are promoting personality cult, see, there is no general overseer, bishop, apostle, pastors, reverend, doctors, gifted man that is the savior or the assistant to the savior. No. No. There is none. So, Satan will want us to now start creating personality cults, start exalting personal attributes, start exalting greatness, because there were certain things they saw in Paul that did not say, I'm of Paul. And before you know it, they took Paul for ultimate. And certain things they saw in Peter, they took Peter for the ultimate. And they start building the influence of individual beyond the work of redemption. Knowing, and you know, no matter how strong and how great a person is, he cannot save, he can't be the savior, he's not going to even speak up for anyone on the day of judgment. So we need to come to realize that. And the other thing Satan does when he's trying to stir up the spirit of sectarianism and division in the body of Christ is to make people take one good issue out of context until it becomes a fulcrum of contention and division. I will explain it to you. You see, Satan is smart. It's not like human. It's a spirit and he has mission and he knows the end. So what he does is to take one good issue. It's a good issue. For example, healing is a good issue. Prosperity is a good issue. Holiness is a good issue. Being zealous for the Lord, anything, doctrine, is a good issue. He will take it and push men to add flesh to it and push it and push it and push it and push it until it becomes an element of contention and a pivot for division. I'll give you an example. So in the scripture where we read, what do you think was the point of contention? Let's go back to that scripture. What was the point of contention? Why did some people say, I'm of Paul, I'm of Peter, I'm of Paul? What are they contending with? It was a good issue. They were dealing with just one thing, which was a good thing. But Satan came on it and it became a sectarianism issue. So for example, political awareness can divide the church so much. This person prefer this candidate, and people start saying things, prophesying, and doing as if we're still dealing in Jews' nation of those days where God is choosing David and choosing Saul. No, we're not. They asked Jesus, when will the kingdom be restored? And he wasn't talking about kingdom, but they were talking about when will the political kingdom be restored back to Israel in the day of Jesus. Acts and chapter 1 and verse 5 and 6 and 7. And Jesus said, that shouldn't be your full concern now. What should be your concern? Verse 8, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you and you will be a witness to me. So it could even be political ideology. It could be anything, which in itself is good. But when people take it to the extreme, then the enemy uses it as element of division, element of contention, an element of damage in the body of Christ. I pray God is going to help us.
Amen.
Now, what was the contention in the Corinth church? Let's read it again. For it has been declared to me that by the people from the house of, let's read from verse 11. For it has been declared to me concerning you by my brethren, by those of close household, there are contention among you. Now I say this, that each of you say, I'm of Paul, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Cephas, I'm of this. Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? Look at verse 14. I thank God that I baptized none, which means the issue was baptism. It was baptism. I thank God I baptized nobody. So that they won't say, I'm the one who started the thing, that if you are not baptized Paul way, you are not a believer. I thank God I baptized none of you except Stripos and Gaius. And Paul started remembering that. How many people did I baptize? Okay, I remember that I was also baptized in the household of Stephanas. Apart from that, I didn't baptize nobody. So I didn't bring baptism. So what their point of contention it was baptism. The first, now there are a lot of things they were fighting about, but the first thing they were fighting about was baptism. And that baptism could be the method and all of that. So, and when you look at it, baptism in its own is good. Is it not? It's good. Mm-hmm. Baptizo, being immersed into Christ, whether as a symbolism in water or being immersed in the Holy Ghost. You know? But men have taken it to another level. If not, listen to me, whether it is prayer or fasting or holiness or purity or even heaven, once heaven, even heaven that we say we're going to, once you push it to the point of contention, now it's now creating contention and division. Satan has come into it. Mm. And there's nothing, don't think there's anything that Satan, people think the only thing Satan uses are things that are mundane and that, no, ephemeral. If you are Satan too, will you just stay in that lane? No. You will, after all, they call it subtlety. So, when the adversary is at work creating sectarianism, what he does is to take one good issue out of context with people and push it until it becomes a fulcrum of contention and division, e.g. baptism as we saw there. So let's look at the last body of knowledge we want to see from those verses today. The way out for you as a Christian is to understand boundaries and recognize limits. Once Christian cannot set, understand boundaries and recognize limits, Scripture says, just like a city without wall, so is a man that has no control over his spirit. Which means, they just stray away. You know, people get involved so much in churchism until they stray and become children of hell. They'll be so angry, incensed to a demonic point, to the point that they don't start acting like they're possessed by demons. A pastor was he told us a story of how he organized a program in his when he was a young man, and some people in the church didn't like it, and then they went to report to their leader, and the person said, "But I took permission before." I said, "Yeah, it doesn't matter." So they made it so bad, and the person was coming from the world wondering that, why are church people like this? I don't want to get involved with this church people thing. And he said years later, but God forced him to apologize and told a part of peace and all of that and all of that. Years later, one of the principal actors said, God save you then, that he already knew he was going to hell. I mean, a Christian, a born again Christian. Maybe the person was dealing with condemnation, maybe he has compromised somewhere, and Satan has sold it to his head that you can't go to heaven again. And so he was looking for who to take. So he's creating offense in the church. So you need to come to understand the place of boundaries, and recognize limits. There are certain points you cannot push things to. As a Christian, no matter how noble the idea, no matter how pious it looks, once you push it to the point of contention, which is gaining undue advantage over your brother, over another denomination, over other people, or put them down or not, you know, and you start breaching specific scriptural principle, I promise you, brother, it's not acceptable of the Lord. Whether interdenomination or intra-denomination, whether between two Christians living in the same house or working in the same place or going to the same church or being in the same department, it makes no difference. So let's go forward and read from verse 14. Again, let's read from, so we said we need to understand, because how did Paul himself escape this? Paul recognized boundaries and he knew limitations. Mm. And that's, once, no matter how anointed you are, no matter how knowledgeable you think you are, if you don't understand boundaries and don't recognize limitation, you will just be one loose cannon on the street. And you might be giving yourself position. You know, these days, people call themselves general in the church. You say, as a general in the body of Christ. Who made you general? I mean, you think of it. It's not even in the Bible. The person who started God General was Robert Liadon, which was a good idea. It's a noble idea. He referred to people who had finished their work and have died then. Now, you can imagine if you join British Army today, can you make yourself general? Say, I've served in this army for 34 years. Now I'm a general. I'm a colonel. No. Or your friends, your group of goons, those who clap for you, say, oh, now, brother, you can't have really served very well in the army. Now we make you a general, a field marshal. It can't happen. So members can't even make their pastor general. Say, general in the God's army. All those things. So, you know, you need to just get out of those things, friends. The only one who assigns accolades, stars, is the person, the British government, in for British Army. The same way, in the kingdom of God, is Jesus, the owner of the church, who can say such. And he won't say such to somebody while you are here. Wait till you get to the other side and get the full reward of your labor. Stop exalting and yourself as if you are more than what you are. Paul recognized boundaries and limits, and it helped him to help the body of Christ. Paul helped, the greatness of Paul united the body of Christ. If your greatness divides the body of Christ, you are not great. If your giftings divided the church, divide the group where you find yourself, you are not properly gifted. Are you getting me now? Now let's read it again, 1 Corinthians from verse 14, now chapter 1. Let's read it, 4 verses. It will give you the idea of what we're saying. 4 verses, verses 14, 15, 16, and 17. He said, I thank God I baptized none except Crispus and Gaius, lest anyone should say I've baptized in my own name. So Paul even knew he can't baptize in his name. He knew his limitation. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanas. Besides, I do not know whether I baptized another person. For, look at verse 17, because Christ did not send me to baptize. So Paul even knew that though he's gifted, he's anointed, he doesn't have it all. But to preach the gospel, not with the wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of no effect. So what we're saying is this, that no individual, no denomination is a know-it-all and do-it-all entity in the body of Christ. None. No pastor, no apostle. You see, you know when we wanted to go on TV some years ago in London, here in year 2014, I believe, I went on Ofcom database to check the how TV station actually reach out. And I realized that many Christian TV stations and many pastors do lie. No, see, they might be not be lying knowingly. They might, it might be there are people behind the scene lying for them. So you hear somebody say, oh, our preaching, we're reaching 2 billion people every year. It's not true. Serious, I promise you, it's not true. Because I went to check Ofcom record, which was scientific. I won't mention stations, but very few stations reach 100,000 people per week. Are you getting me now? Statistics. One day God told me, God said, you know, if you have a church today that has, he said, there's hardly any Pentecostal church that has 80 million people today. There's hardly any. I mean, I'm talking of member base. There's hardly. I'm not sure if there are. Side Catholic church, there's no church that has even 1 billion. There's even 1 billion. But 80 million. Just 80 million. But do you know if a Pentecostal church has 80 million membership? I'm talking of members, not people watching. Members. That you can say in this church we have 5,000, this we have 10,000. And when we have it together, 80 million. There's hardly, there's none. That church, the pastor will be so exalted to the highest heaven that people could always equate him to Jesus. Say, if this Jesus is talking, this guy is talking. This, don't you know the result he has? But listen to me. God told me, God said, do you know that man church is not more than 1% of the world population? If you do an exam and you score 1%, you didn't pass. Let's do more. He said, if a church has 800 million people and there's none. The only, you know, Catholic Church came around 330, and he's the only one who's close to that. And of course, you know, it's state church and all of that. Not even Church of England. 800 million people. He said, if any church has that number of members, the way the body of Christ is, we almost even, such people who ask all other pastors, shut up, keep your mouth quiet, I'm talking here. Do you know the, but is that church doesn't have more than 10% of the world population, and that's the living population, and the people who are dead are more than people who are living. What was the lesson there? Which means no matter how big the result in your hand, no matter how much you think you know, endowed, you see, you, nobody, no church, no individual in a group in the church, no church as a body is a know-it-all, have-it-all individual or church in the body of Christ. Not at all. Not at all. In fact, the marking script of saints is not being given to the hand of anybody. In that case, you need to humble yourself. And that's what Paul was saying here. Paul said, listen, Christ didn't send me to baptize anybody. I baptized just a few people. I know the limit. I know what I was asked to preach and what I was asked to do. I don't have it all. I don't know it all. Okay, they've shown me that the time is off. I have just 3 minutes. Okay, good. So if you look at a scripture like 1 Corinthians and chapter 12, it says that we are member of Christ, body of Christ, members in particular, from verse 27 downward. Members in particular. So which means no matter how big you are just a member. Amen. So in that case, if you understand the boundaries and the limits, then you will know that you are unique, truly, but you are sent to promote Christ. Talk is cheap. You know, and that's what Paul is saying there. He said, I've not been doing talking. He said, it's not just in words. He said, talk is cheap. I've been sent to promote Christ. Okay, yeah, so let's just stop it there today. So we can see here that as Christians, we should understand the concept of diversity is recognized by God, but we should understand when sectarianism comes in, which is the work of the devil. And how do you as a person, whether in your local assembly, whether dealing with other Christians, whether you are a leader of church, dealing with denomination, you should come to understand that there's no know-it-all, have-it-all in the body of Christ, no matter how seemingly big, or how seemingly popular, or how seemingly famous, or how seemingly anointed or powerful you may be. You are sent to witness Christ and to witness Christ alone. There's never going to be a time Jesus will vacate his seat and ask one pastor or one leader to come and sit there and be the one that will determine the blessedness and the judgment of saints. You need to come to terms with that very quickly and do what is acceptable to the Lord as a Christian. Praise God. Amen. All right, the time is gone. We've got just, let me see, just 2 minutes. Let's quickly pray then. Let's pray for the body of Christ. Say, Lord Jesus, help us to have one voice, one mind, and one judgment in your body, in the name of Jesus. Lord, the diversity you've allowed, we promote it, we allow it, let it work. And Lord, we come against sectarianism, the devil of division and contention in the body of Christ, from Europe to Africa, from Asia to America, North and South. By the blood of Jesus, we come against division, sectarianism, we come against contention in the body of Christ, in the name of Jesus Christ. Every tree that God has not planted in the church, let them be rooted out. We destroy the works of Satan in the body of Christ. We release the spirit of love, of unity, oneness of mind, mercy and hope. We release it in that other church. Oneness of mind. We release it in other churches. We release it in the body of Christ. In the Adam Church, London, and in the body of Christ generally, we release help to love, help to esteem others than oneself. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Oh yes, Lord. Ramakadiyano tu berizo ziko ti malik ramash. Mangrodies kilimondra nakurmoste emprable kuri shalamangres lestomrliano sukamayana moste. In the biro zizo dile biro kita paya dam rodisk. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Receive grace for yourself. Say, Lord, I receive grace to walk in newness of life as somebody who has been rescued from the fall. I don't want to walk like Gentile walk. I want to walk in unity. I want to walk in with the right mind, even when we are doing things differently, with the right mind, with the right perspective. In the name of Jesus, I receive the renewal. Let this mind. He didn't say it's there. He said, let it be there. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ, which means you're the one that permitted. I receive grace. I permit the mind of Christ to permit my thought, my mind, in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh yes, Lord, thank you. And I give you praise. Blessed be your name, Lord. Now go ahead and give God praise and thanks. He heard you. And blessed be his holy name. Blessed be his holy name. Blessed be his holy name. We give him praise now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh yes, thank you, Lord. Anyone who has something you want to ask of the Lord, I believe in miracle. Go ahead and ask him. In the name of Jesus, healing in your body. Yes, released. Oh, help for you, wherever it is you are trusting God for. The Lord said, come unto me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I bring unto you now the name of Jesus, that which Christ labored for, died for. The fruit of redemption, the manifestation of the miracles, by the name of Jesus Christ, turn around for you right now. In the name of Jesus, it is done. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' marvelous name, we pray. Immortal God, we thank you and we give you praise. Thank you for knowledge of your word. And Lord, we receive grace not just to be preachers or hearers of your word. We receive grace to be doers. And to the end that our glory may arise and your name might be glorified.
Amen.
In Jesus' marvelous name we pray.
Amen.
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 All right. I'll see you next week in midweek service like this. Like I said, I'm going to do run this teaching through December. Then generally, I've seen in my spirit that I generally will pray for 3 months. Then we'll come back to teaching again and like that. So that, you know, the diversity. Yeah. All right. Sunday service is going to be powerful. God has ushered us into season of abundance.
Amen.
And abundance now is more than just material abundance. We're talking of abundance from perspective of abundant life.
Amen.
And it's going to find manifestation in your hand.
Amen.
If you have not registered for the service, try and go and register for the service. If you have registered and you won't be able to make it, I plead with you in the name of Jesus, Son of God, please go and cancel. If you don't know how to cancel, send message to us that you want to cancel, send to church phone, not my phone, church phone. Yeah, good. Now, so that they can give those space to many people who really want to come. I know a lot of people are lamenting they couldn't register, they couldn't get to register because the number is limited. So please do that. No offense is taken. We love you with the love of God.
Amen.
The Lord bless you.
Amen.
The Lord keeps you.
Amen.
The Lord make his face to shine upon you.
Amen.
The Lord be gracious to you.
Amen.
The Lord lift up his countenance
on
you. May he give you peace.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
This teaching is available on YouTube, so you can go and download it on YouTube, send it out to people, and listen to it again and again. The Lord bless you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Blessed be God. Bless you.
Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Everybody say,
glory to the Lamb.
We sing
glory, glory to the Lamb.
We give all glory
to the Lamb.
Yes, we sing
glory,
glory to the
to
Lamb.
The Lamb.
And this is why. For he is
Alpha
and Omega,
Omega.
Forever is he. And he will reign forever. Holy, holy, holy. Holy is he. So together let's sing
glory
to the Lamb. Father, we sing tonight glory. Glory to the Lamb. Jesus is his name, we give
glory,
glory to the Lamb.
To the Lamb.
For he
is
the beginning,
okay.
And he is the end,
forever
he remains. And he will reign forever, with all power and authority.
To the Lamb,
we give all glory.
give glory to the Lamb. The sovereign one, we give glory to the Lamb. The almighty one, we give glory. Are your deeds just and true? Are your words, Lord God Almighty? Who will not fear you, O Lord, and bring glory to your name? You alone are holy, and all nations will come and worship before you. Saints and angels sing, the saints and angels sing, glory to the Lamb.